What I'm going to do is to focus on the challenges of governing cyberspace, especially in relation to the peace and security issues, given the current focus on cyber warfare and the dangers that it poses. I wanted to reflect on some of the experiences from the arms control domain of the last many decades, and how does that explain some of the challenges and difficulties that we face in the political and the policy domain at this point of time. I will also look at briefly in terms of the challenges that what kind of a policy that India might develop in the coming years in relation to cyber governance, in relation to peace and security issues. The first part I wanted to mention was, where are we now? What is the state of play in relation to the governance of Zimmerman or otherwise, of what is the state of play in terms of the current negotiations, current discussions at the international level? On the one hand, there is a growing demand, a growing recognition, some of it we heard this morning, that there's a need for international cooperation, that the cybersecurity threats cannot be managed purely through a national framework. While national security is important, you need some kind of an international cooperation. Now, with that broadly, I think that idea has gained quite a bit of a ground in the last few years. Now, what would the treaty? There is a lot of talk about a cyber convention or a cyber treaty that would deal with the peace and security issues. What might a cyber treaty, assuming that we're going to get one, we're going to negotiate one, what does it do? What can it do in the present circumstances? Such a convention, for example, could actually provide agreed definitions on the issues involved. Because quite clearly, a number of concepts, there is no actual agreement between states, between expert groups, between different countries. The second thing that such a convention can do is to generate a set of norms. That is not law, at least what are the acceptable norms of behavior in cyberspace for states. The third, it can also promote confidence building measures and promote cooperation between between countries. More importantly, I think one of the principal purposes of such a treaty, one would assume, would be to impose some limits on what states can do to each other in war and peace, and that these limitations, I think that there are certain prohibitions, what is prohibited, what is permitted, clarification of those is another option. And finally, of course, like all good conventions, you could promote an international organization that would actually supervise and manage the challenges of cybersecurity. The good news is that there is some progress on this front. The group of governmental experts that German delegate spoke about in its latest report, the third iteration, has broadly come to some interesting conclusions, and I think which are an advance in the debate on cyber governance over the last many years. One is that the group has declared that the current international law, including the principles of UN Charter, and broadly the laws of war, would apply to the states. Second thing they've said is that the prohibitions on use of force between states and the question of respect for territorial integrity and the sovereignty of states, peaceful resolution of disputes, all these have been endorsed as applying to a cyberspace. The group has also said the right for self-defense, which is granted under the UN Charter, also applies to the cyberspace. The good news is that I think in terms of the debate, we're moving towards some broad consensus. But the bad news is, all these sound nice, but the question is, in actually defining each of these well-known principles, of course, all of us know the UN Charter and its interpretation of its thing has never been an easy one for the international community. So I think the challenge for the coming years is going to be, if we're going to extend the international law and the UN Charter, international law of war, and the Charter to the cyberspace domain, then how do we work out the specifics in the coming years, and how do we actually translate this broad consensus into a specific agreement between ourselves? So that brings me to the problems that we're going to face as we proceed towards generating some kind of a common international understanding. Now, here I think the experience of arms control, we already see some of the terminology from arms control is already beginning to influence the debate on cybersecurity, whether it is deterrence, cyber deterrence, cyber preemption, CBM, you name it, much of the jargon from the arms control domain has come into the debates on cyber security. I would look at least the four tensions that we've got to deal with, given our experience with arms control in negotiating any kind of cyber treaty. One is between law and strategy. Much of the current debate is largely focused on, look, can we apply the existing principles of international law to the cyber domain? But much of this does not take into account the national strategic interests of the major powers. So while it's all right to talk about expanding strategy, expanding law towards the cyberspace domain, the whole question of the interests, the strategic interests, and the strategies that states adopt, at managing the intersection between the two is going to be a big problem. Because any serious policy framework that we devise must be able to deal with the dynamic interplay between law and strategy. Strategy, for example, generates reappraises and produces revision of law, where law itself shapes strategy, and how states do and states behave and compete with each other is simultaneously shaped by law and transcends law. And law has to catch up most of the time with the changes in technology and strategy. B is the tension between, in any international negotiation, the tension between the multilateral approach and the great power dynamic. Most of us love multilateral negotiations. Everybody sits in a room. We're all going to build consensus. But what matters in the end is not what the large committee of the whole produces, but what the great powers do. For example, just one example in the Outer Space Treaty, 1967, we proclaimed that peaceful use of outer space. But what followed was the most vigorous competition for militarization of space between the Americans and the Russians. So what followed, of course, that did not violate space law as defined by Outer Space Treaty. But what it did was to actually create a process which was very, very different from the broad norms. Because in a committee of the whole, you can at best produce very macro, very general propositions. Well, actually, the states, the big powers, produce outcomes which are very, very different. And dealing with the great power dynamic, what great powers do, perhaps is more consequential and sometimes than what the collective as a whole produces. The third set of problems, I think, is the in relation to arms control is the tension between the great powers themselves. It's not the rivalry between the great powers. While they might sometimes agree, for example, they agreed on non-proliferation, okay, nuclear weapons should not proliferate to the others. But they were simultaneously producing nuclear weapons, there was a nuclear rivalry. So in a sense, you do not really solve the core problem because of the tension between the major powers. And today what we see in the cyber domain are some interesting contradictions between the positions of the East and West. I mean, to simplify, one, you have the West generally talks about the protection of the computer networks from damage and theft. Well, Russia and China tend to emphasize a lot more on information security, controlling the content and communication of the systems which might threaten regime stability. These are two fundamentally different set of interests in terms of what are the political goals you're trying to achieve through the cybersecurity stuff. For example, there are also proposals sometimes you have. What seems a logical proposal from one side is utterly contested by the other. For example, some in the West propose, let's exclude civilian ICT targets from cyber warfare. Now, if I was sitting in China, Russia, of course, I would say, look, fine, because US has got a vulnerability on the civilian side. US is very good at launching its own cyber military attacks. So therefore, why should I accept a prohibition? Which seems normal. From first principles, it seems a logical one. But others would not necessarily accept the kind of outcome that comes out of seemingly good first principle. Then there is probably the other problem when major powers deal with arms control or restrictions and prohibitions. Most of the time, big powers would want to, each of them would want to protect where they got an advantage and restrict the seeming advantage on the other side. I mean, it's from child's play. I mean, this is what we do from childhood. But in the case of international law today, the question of how does this attempt at protecting one's own advantage by one set of powers and to undermine that by the others produces fundamental tensions between the two. And then there is also the question of the fourth one, which is the logic of asymmetry. Arms control, for all its high principles, just even on the case of cyber governance, the effects of any international convention are asymmetrically impact on different countries. Not everybody is affected the same way. And here, especially in the case of great powers, what seems logical from the perspective of one would look a threatening element from the other. Then you have the asymmetric nature of the regime. Some are democracies, some are not. For some regime, stability is more important than freedom of expression. So that tension, again, I think the nature of the domestic politics produces negotiating positions, which are fundamentally different. And then you have the asymmetric impact of state responsibility. We talked this morning about attribution issue. Does state take responsibility when something happens on its territory? Now, those of us who know, for example, in India, those of us who know on terrorism, even when the whole problem today in India, that the question of cross-border terrorism, Pakistan says, look, they can't be attributed to the state. Now, if you can't do anything about it, despite the UN laws and conventions that are being passed, how are you going to fix state responsibility when something happens from one state's territorial control for all these claims about sovereignty? How do you actually hold someone responsible? So I think it's easy to say sovereignty extends, state responsibility must be primary. The question is, can you actually enforce it in a fundamental sense? All this does not mean, of course, we can't negotiate a convention. And I think the challenge is, how do we at least begin to produce some limited outcomes? They're not going to be dramatic outcomes, but at least narrowly focused, specific cooperation can be produced between different countries. That brings me to the third point. I mean, I think, where does India figure in this? One, I think, the India's traditional approach to international negotiations in the peace and security areas, I think, can be characterized by three Ds. One, there is a disarmament approach, the total elimination approach, as opposed to arms control. To no limited agreements, India's traditional emphasis on let's eliminate the bad stuff, everyone gets the same rules. The second one is on developmentalism, that look, any prohibition should not prevent the development of the underdeveloped country. The third one is the opposition to discrimination. And you heard the minister say this morning about equinet. So the idea of equity, justice, or something that tend to be central to the rhetoric of the Indian political classes. And you would see all these three elements historically have dominated the Indian discourse on arms control. But the fact is, many of these big ideas of first principles came into clash with how India had to sort out its nuclear problem with the international system. And as a result, we've seen in the last decade and a half, more pragmatism, more willingness to accept limited arms control, more willingness to be part of the global system rather than trying to stand outside and criticize it. So there is a tension between, do you emphasize first principles and produce a universalist, morally sound agreement? Or do you emphasize your national security interests and seek where India benefits from the international negotiation? I think there is a fundamental tension in the Indian position. And what we see happening in the last 2-3 years as the Indian cybersecurity internet issues have come about, one stream tends to emphasize the traditional multilateralist approach. If you see the Indian proposal in the UN, or the UN Committee on Internet Management, that there is one set of ideas. But if you follow Mr. Shivshankar Menon's speeches, he's emphasizing, look, you've got to be pragmatic, you've got to have international cooperation, let's keep working with the rest of the world and benefit from such cooperation. So I think where we've reached is that cusp in the Indian debate. My own sense is that India's own long-term interests are going to be, how does it manage its national security interests? Does it work as a responsible power with the rest of the major powers? Or does it emphasize the third worldism, you know, everyone ought to be equal, that kind of past approach? My sense is, I think it's moving towards a practical approach, moving towards emphasis of India's responsibility and its emergence as a contributor to the management of international order.
Thank you very much, Raj.